you know, we hear people, especially in Colorado now, say that marijuana is not a gateway drug. And that's fine if people want to believe that, but for me it was, and everybody that I ever knew that was on meth started with marijuana.
Right.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
Mac and Mary, welcome to Focus on the Family.
Oh, thank you. We're glad to be here.
In so many ways, when I read your book, Never Let Go, you lived this. I mean, This has been your story, and we're going to uncover it and dig into it because it's so helpful and so relevant to today's culture. I mean, not only are some of the fashions coming back, is that kind of
spooky?
That's
right.
Yeah. I mean, bell bottoms are coming, daisies, you know, on cars.
But the white platform shoes aren't coming back. That's the good news.
You still have them in your closet, though. But also, just that residual of the drug culture also seems to be coming back in powerful ways. So let's get into it. You two met. I want to get into this, how you met, because it is such a 70s story. How did you guys meet?
I was a junior and he was a sophomore.
What?
Isn't that?
Yeah, I married an older woman. That's right.
Yeah,
okay, right there. You were going for the upper class.
That's
women.
Right. That's right.
And I was in American history class. And I got sent out in the hallway because I was talking too much in class. I was standing in the hallway. It was a long hallway. I looked down and I see this huge, looks like 24-inch diameter afro coming down the hallway. And it was bobbing up and down. And I was like, who is that? And he came walking by and he said hello. And I said hello. And I just loved his smile and his bright blue eyes. And I thought, I need to get to know him.
Well, wow, you really captivated
your
wife.
Yeah, I have that personality. But
and the hair thing worked for you.
Yeah, it did. It worked for me very well.
Mac, what attracted you to Mary?
Well, I saw her at school first, too, and I just thought, wow, now she is good looking. And I found out that she was going to be going to a Christian summer camp because, you know, we were brought up in very good Christian homes. And, that's, I think, part of our story is that even when kids are brought up in good Christian homes, they can make poor decisions that affect their life for their life.
Well, and that's one of the reasons, as a parent listening, I want you to dial into this, because so many kids who grew up in Christian homes, they go off to college or vocational training, they're going to be exposed to things. And if they're not ready, they could be snared by the enemy. And this is one of the reasons we're doing the program. But Mac, growing up in that Christian home. So.
Yeah, and we weren't ready, like you said, because in our home, we didn't talk about real issues.
Yeah.
You know, you went to church on Sunday, but we were living that whole different life as soon as we got out of church.
And your parents didn't know that. Is that fair? Or did they have suspicions, but they thought, okay, it's
no,
all right.
No, for Mary's dad and mom.
My parents did not know. Right. Yeah, because I hid it well, and I didn't smoke cigarettes or anything, so I didn't have the smell on me when I would come home like Mac did. So they knew he was smoking cigarettes and starting to get rebellious, but I was a little more cautious because I didn't want to hurt my parents.
Yeah.
I love my parents, but the peer pressure was so hard back then. I mean, it was, you know, I wanted to be popular. I wanted people to like me. So if everybody was smoking pot, well, then I was going to try it too, you know.
And you were a straight-A student. You were a good girl. That's how, the book describes you and your
cum
parents.
Cum laude.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, top of the class, the whole bit. You were the poster child of a Christian home, right?
Yes.
And then, Mac, you were kind of becoming rebellious. Mary tipped the beans there, spilled the beans. What was that like?
Well, I was living in a Christian home. My dad went to seminary. That's why we moved to Louisiana. And so he was a preacher, and I felt like I just didn't fit in because I couldn't talk about any of the things that were really bothering me, because if I did, you weren't supposed to talk about that being in a Christian home.
Right.
Now, I was the only one of my siblings that went down the path that I went down.
Yeah.
So,
well, let's uncover that a little bit.
Yeah.
What did that look like on a Friday night for you in high school? What you're going to be at church on Sunday, but what were you doing Friday night and Saturday night?
Well, Friday night and Saturday. Yeah, actually, it started on about Monday, I think, getting ready
night.
You know, but Friday night we were looking for anything we could do to get out of the house and have as much fun as we possibly could. And for me, having fun was smoking pot with my friends, drinking, coming back in at the nick of time to beat the curfew, you know. So really, it was everything that I could do to get away from my parents' rule, as I felt it.
Yes.
It was just that whole idea that if you have a problem, we won't talk about it and it will get better.
Yeah.
And
I can understand that. I think I suffer from that at times as a parent. You kind of, yeah, you know what? It's just
too much information, right?
Well, or it'll get better. Yeah. You know, yeah. Don't upset it too much. But speak to that inability to have a discussion and how that pushed you, it sounds like, or the hypocrisy, maybe. Because Christianity is not about perfection, but sometimes we in the church are trying to project, look at us, we're perfect. Mm-hmm. And even sometimes we're not trying to do that, but it's what the statement is. And you were having struggles with that as a teenager, right? You're going, okay, it's not perfect, therefore they're hypocrites. Is that kind of what you were?
That's kind of what I was feeling. It was like, since we don't talk about feelings and what we're dealing with, then actually I was thinking, I must be the one that's not right.
Okay. So it doesn't fit for you.
So, right, it doesn't fit for me. And so for me to get away from that was a goal. Yeah. And I just didn't want to be a part of something that I didn't feel like was real.
And Mary, you're seeing this. I'm sure when you guys are out together, you're talking about that. That's part of your bonding relationship, what you're seeing in your Christian family, what Mac's seeing in his. I'm assuming you talked about that. Was that part of the attraction to Mac, mm-hmm. that he sees the world maybe in many ways the way you're seeing
yeah.
it?
Yeah. Well, I just didn't like him and his dad. They would fight about his hair being so big. And it was just, I just thought, wow, you know, is that the most important thing? And another thing is, there was no such thing as youth ministers then, or youth pastor. Well, there wasn't in our church.
Just everybody went to church together.
Everybody went to church. So yeah. the kids that I went to church with, many of them, you know, were like backbiting and gossiping, you know, about each other and stuff. Then when I met him and met his friends, they were all just so welcoming and like, yes, come be with us. And we'll have, they didn't care where you were from, what you did, mm-hmm. just come have fun. So on the weekends, we'd go out in the woods and have a big bonfire. And they'd have like a keg or two of beer, and everybody would just, nobody was like talking about anybody. Nobody was doing anything mean. Everybody was just having a fun time listening to rock and roll. So I thought, now what's wrong with this? You know, I go to church on Sunday morning, but they're not being real nice to each other on Sunday morning.
Yeah.
But on the weekends, we're having a fun time. So I don't understand this.
You know, we'll get to it, but I think the way this is shaping up is it's time to teach the parents a little lesson here. So being parents now, going through that, what's that advice when you have, you know, a teenager and you have this struggle going on? How can we be more real as parents and also be realistic about the importance of faith and how we transmit our faith to our kids, but do it in such a way that makes it desirable?
Yeah. Well, no subject can be taboo. And when we started raising our kids, that was our motto. Anything our kids ever needed to talk about, we were going to sit down and talk about it.
So be open-minded about the discussion.
Yeah, no matter how uncomfortable we felt.
Right.
Yeah, because there was plenty of times that we were like, oh my, they're going to talk about this.
Yeah, we'd think, oh my goodness, I wish they wouldn't tell us so much. But we'd think that to ourselves. But then in front of them, we wouldn't act shocked.
We would just listen. Yeah, that's a good thing. That's healthy.
Yes, it is. Yes.
In your book, Never Let Go, you describe some of the reckless decisions you made over the next several years. You're together, but probably over the next 7 years or so. For example, you had an unexpected pregnancy while you were still in high school. Mm. I'm sure that's painful. What happened? What did you learn from it? How did it set your trajectory for the next couple of years?
Well, again, that was one of those subjects that we never talked about at home. Matter of fact, I got a book when I was a senior in high school that was laid on my bed when I came in, Everything I Needed to Know About Sex, uh-huh. from my parents. By this time, we'd already had a child.
They didn't know that?
They didn't know that. Mm-hmm. We never told my parents. Mary's dad knew, but we never told my parents until later on. And that's a part of my recovery was when I had to go make amends to my parents for keeping that from them.
Yeah.
But yeah, so.
And in my home, my dad actually sat me down one day and told me about the birds and the bees. I could tell he was so uncomfortable, you know, what he was trying. And Mac and I were already having sex. And so I'm just sitting there thinking, you're telling me something I already know. So I think it's so important for us to talk to our kids when they're young, you know, age appropriate, when they ask questions, to answer them. So, you know, that also we don't tell them something that they've already heard in school.
Talk about that guilt and shame that you did experience. I mean, these are behaviors that, of course, growing up in a Christian home is going to sink the heart of every parent. Mm-hmm. But speak to your personal experience there about what you really felt. And that was many years ago, I know. Yeah. But what was it like to go through that experience? And what happened? Where did you go? And how did you keep it from Mac's parents?
Mary's mom had paranoid schizophrenia.
Okay.
So that's why when she said her dad sat down and told her the story about sex. So one day her mom was in the hospital. Her dad was out of town. We ended up at her house, and it wasn't planned. We just ended up there, and next thing we knew, we were having sex. And it was the first time for both of us. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't like she was promiscuous and I had never had sex before. It just happened because we had too much alone time.
Right.
And so afterwards, I mean, immediately both of us were like, what just happened? What did we just do? And so I said, we can never do that again. You know, I know that was wrong. We shouldn't have done it. But then, you know, a couple of days later, Mac's thinking, you know, let's try that again. You know, I was like, no, we're not doing this anymore. Well, the next month, I didn't start my period. And I thought, no, there's no way. I've got lots of friends that do this all the time, and they're not pregnant. So
you can't get pregnant after one time. I mean, surely that.
And so I waited 4 months before I went to a doctor. You talk about being in denial. I just thought, if I don't think this is not happening. And so I went to my dad one day, and I said, Dad, I got something to tell you. And he was taking a nap on the couch, and I knelt down to him, and I said, I'm pregnant. And he just, tears broke out in his eyes. He goes, I knew you were. But he said, I kept thinking, if you don't say it, maybe it's not true. Maybe I'm just dreaming up in my mind. But he said, you know what? I'll love you always. And we'll do whatever you want to do. And I said, well, I've talked to a doctor already, and he knows our family. He knows mama's problems. And he said, if your mother ever finds out about this, it will put her in a mental institution for the rest of her life.
Oh, man.
And so I told my dad, I said, Dad, you're an elder in the church. They'll kick you out of the church. They're going to put me up on the stage and tar and feather me. I said, I can't go. I've got to give my baby up for adoption. That's the only option there is. And he said, well, I'll handle the private adoption then. And so he did. And so I went down. I said, I can go with my best friend and move in with them and stay with them until the baby's born.
My goodness. I mean, the feelings, there's so many emotions to go through right there. You had shame. You're in a Christian home, right?
Yes.
Let me ask you about the friends. I mean, the parents. How did your friends' parents treat you in that environment? I mean,
they were so sweet.
That's good.
Yes, they were good Christians and so sweet, and they just were very welcoming. And
helped you.
They helped me. Yes, they did. And I just stayed in their home and never went anywhere, never went out, you know, into town or anything like that, because I wanted to keep it a secret. I thought, if I've made it this far, I need to make sure I go through with this and this happens.
Yeah. Boy, that resolve. At some point, you marry each other. It wasn't because of this pregnancy, but how long after the adoption do you get married? And
it was a year.
A year later.
Well, no,
one,
a year
one
and
a
half.
Half.
Okay,
yeah.
Year and a half later.
Yeah. I went ahead with my senior year of high school. She went to, she got a job. We continued to date during that time, even though her dad did say that he never wanted me to see his daughter again. But we did continue to date. But, you know, I will say one point there, too, about her dad. You know, I look back on this story, and I see the time that Mary went and knelt down in front of that couch. And her dad had such a fatherly love, like our Heavenly Father, that he would say, you know what? I don't care what you've done. I'm going to love you like my daughter. And we're going to get through this together. Even though he had a lot to lose during that time, because nobody had pregnancies during that time, or very little anyway.
They didn't tell them. It was a secret.
That nobody talked about it, for sure. And so just the love that he had for Mary really really made an impression on me.
Yeah. Mac, drug addiction is really the opening here, and I don't want to keep coming back to that, but describe your life at this time. And even though Mary has kind of turned the corner and decided she wants to be healthy, she wants to pursue God, she wants to, you know, have a good family, she's married you, but you're not responding in the same way, which must have torn your heart up, Mary. I don't know.
Yes.
You know, you're in the spot.
Did. Oh, I would put articles by his side of the bed, you know, hoping he would read them. And I would ask him sometimes, I was like, what do you think is going to happen to you if you don't turn your life around? What's going to happen if you die? Where do you think you're going to go?
Wow.
And because I just thought, he's got to turn his life around. He is, you know, but I really didn't know all that he was doing, but I just knew he wasn't living for God.
Well, and you're a young wife at this time. I mean, 17?
Yeah, well,
18 when she got married. Okay. I was 19 when we got married.
So 19 and 18. So you're learning a lot about what it means just to set up the household and, yes. and be a wife. And yeah. and then, Mac, you're trying to live a life that you want to have fun and just, you know, go.
And I wanted her to be involved in that, too. So it wasn't like I was just living my life. I wanted to pull her along with me, even though she was, like, laying articles beside my bed and stuff. I was like, hey, come go with me, you know.
And so that's a good description of a tug-of-war.
And actually, when we were first married, I did go with them to parties. Until we had our first daughter. I partied with him during that time. I kind of went back down that road because I wanted to be with him. It was my husband, and you know, we were having fun together. And
right.
all these people, it was fun.
I would call it party light.
I was party light.
Yeah, you would come, but yeah, you would sort of be. She was there with the people, but
yeah.
you know, just if I could encourage her to do some things, she would. But most of the time, she was like, I don't really want.
Okay, so you find out you're pregnant again.
Yes, yeah, so
a second
I stopped.
Time.
Yeah, stopped
so that
everything. I
shuts
said,
it down.
This is it. I'm not going to parties anymore. And you know, that was kind of sad to not get to be with him anymore. Yeah, you because know, he kept going. And sometimes I would go, but I just wouldn't party. And I'd
right.
look at everybody else drunk and high and thinking,
yeah.
this is ridiculous how mm-hmm. I used to act.
And Mac, you describe in your book a story about your two daughters being with you to go pick up some drugs. Mm-hmm. And that you can see in the book where the Lord's after you in mm-hmm. these punctuated moments. They grab your heart.
Right.
And maybe Mary was playing a role in that as well because her words were making sense to you. But describe that story of what happened and that first kind of twinge of there's something bigger going on.
Right. Our kids were both going to a Christian school, you know, because even though I was out living this life, I still knew that there was something better. I was going to hell.
So you had two kids right. at this point. This is a
had
few
two
years
kids,
later.
And I had accepted the fact that I wasn't going to make it to heaven. But I didn't want them to miss out. So, but obviously there was still some time in there where I wasn't making good decisions because I went to pick them up at Christian school one day to bring them home. It's about a 30-minute drive. I decided to stop by a meth dealer's house to pick up some drugs on the way home so I wouldn't be without. And after I stopped there, left them in the car, me go inside to get my drugs, come back out. By the time I get home, something just hit me and I was just like, how stupid can you really be?
Mm.
And it was that it was a small moment of clarity. Mm. The large moment of clarity didn't hit till later, but that was that first little, you know what, I've got to do better.
Yeah.
But still, I mean, you know, I can think I've got to do better, but if my actions don't prove it, and they didn't, how much did I really want to do better?
Yeah. So in that regard, to describe the drug use, I mean, you started with pot and eventually it got to more serious addictions, if I could say it that way, with meth and other things. Describe what happened. Why did you rationalize this would be an okay step to go to meth? Meth is a horrific addiction.
Well, you know, we hear people, especially in Colorado now, say that marijuana is not a gateway drug. And that's fine if people want to believe that, but for me it was. And everybody that I ever knew that was on meth started with marijuana.
Right,
so
right. I think the evidence is pretty strong that it is.
Right, right. And so for me, it was just that next step, you know, hey, you can stay up all night. You can stay up for several days at a time if you want to.
Yeah.
And I was like, wow, this is really cool. And so meth just became, and there was a lot of other drugs in between marijuana and meth, but meth became that drug that just clicked for me, and I could stay up all night, felt like I was being productive at our cabinet shop, when in fact I was being very unproductive, but my mind was telling me, oh, you're getting a lot of stuff done here.
I didn't even know it, that I thought, my husband is becoming insane is all I can figure out.
Really? So you didn't even know now?
No. I knew he was still partying, but I had no idea that he was using meth.
Yeah.
He kept that hidden.
Mary, in that regard, what did you do to start to rescue Mac? I mean, were there things, steps that you took? Did you continue to nag, if I can use that word?
Yes.
Hey, Mac, come to church. Yes, what was that like in your relationship?
Oh, well, I figured out it didn't work. Because whatever I did to nag him or try to get him to do family things together, it just pushed him away even more. So once I saw that it's not working to me try to force him to turn his life around. So what I did is I started working on myself. And my relationship with God got stronger and stronger. And I told God, I said, God, I am trusting Romans 8:28, that you say all things work together for the good for those who love the Lord. And I don't see one good thing coming out of this, but I'm trusting something good. You've got a plan and you are going to work something good. I might not see it till heaven, but I'm still going to trust you. So I'm going to keep my spiritual eyes on you, even though my physical eyes are seeing something totally different.
Yeah. Mary, how hard was that for you? Because it's hard to do. There's visible, tangible expressions of sin going on. Yeah. And it's hard to turn your attention away from the sinner and onto your own life with Christ to find peace and joy even in the midst of it. So how did you discipline yourself every day to move closer to God? And then if Mac could come along, that's great. Yes. But if not, he's God's, not yours.
Well, I got into God's Word, reading His Word every day. See, I grew up, my mother wrote Bible verses on 3x5 cards and taped them up all over our bathroom walls. So those verses would come back to me, remembering them. And so I thought, wow, I think that's something I need to pay attention to. I need to say those in my head over and over. So I just started saying different verses and writing them on 3x5 cards and carrying them around with me. And so every time a worry thought would come in my head, I would say that Bible verse.
Yeah.
The only thing I wish I would have had back then that I have now is, you know, I have accountability partners. I have a sponsor. I was so afraid to tell anybody what we were going through, so I kept it all to myself. So I was about to have a nervous breakdown, you know, just trying to do it on my own, just me and God by ourselves. But I really believe God expects that He wants us to be in relationship with His people. And it would have been easier if I would have talked to other people about it instead of trying to keep it a secret.
But you remember, too, always Isaiah 41:10. That was that life preserver verse.
My mother said this so many times. Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be afraid, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Isaiah 41:10. She said that so many times because, you know, she had demons in her mind that made her fearful, and she would say that out loud and speak that over us because she was afraid something was going to hurt us. And so that scripture came back to me, so I would say it out loud.
It's a good reminder. I mean, Jesus is the Redeemer. Amen. That's the whole point of this program.
Amen.
And Mac, we've started to kind of peel back the early days. I want to come back next time, Mac, because you had a near-death experience, drug-related, that will kick off the discussion how God begins to redeem you through Mary and through your family and how He got your attention finally. So can we do that?
You bet.
All right.
Yes, thank you.
Hey, I'm John Fuller, and thanks for watching. Get more info about Focus over here and more from our guests over there, and be sure to subscribe to our channel as well.